What you're looking at is a piece of radioactive material in a special machine called a cloud chamber. Each of those little trails is the wake left behind by a particle of radiation known as an alpha particle. Really, it's just a helium nucleus that's been ejected from the radioactive material at high speed and without any electrons. So how is it possible to see all those tracks even though the particles themselves are functionally invisible? Well, that is the magic of a cloud chamber. All that's required to make one is an extremely cold plate, some alcohol vapor, and a bit of high voltage. It's set up so a pad soaked in alcohol is above the metal plate, and a metal grid is placed between them. The high voltage is connected between the cold plate and the upper grid. Once the plate is below negative 26 Celsius, the alcohol vapor slowly drifting down onto it forms a supersaturated layer of gas, where the alcohol wants to condense into a liquid, as seen by this snow of fog of alcohol droplets. Just like hot ice, which is a supersaturated mixture of sodium acetate, all it takes is the tiniest nudge to get things to suddenly change states. In this case, the nudge is from the trail left behind as a particle of ionizing radiation flies through the chamber. If you live in the US, making a cloud chamber is super easy. You just walk in your local grocery store, buy a hunk of dry ice the size of your head for $5, and you'll be able to make a massive chamber by just putting a big metal plate on the block. But I'm Canadian, and access to cryogenics at the grocery store just isn't something we have. And while we considered just setting this up outside in winter, it's springtime now, so that's a non-starter. So rather than dry ice, I built mine using the same cheap Peltier cooling units that you use to keep your CPU cool. The other benefit of this is that you can essentially run these continuously so long as you remember to top up the alcohol from time to time. Before we jump into the build, I want to briefly talk about why I built this. Contrary to what you might think based on the number of bio videos on this channel, I got my start in science by learning about nuclear and particle physics. I've been a nuclear nerd for probably 10 years and have always been fascinated by particle physics. As such, I've wanted a cloud chamber for probably just as long. But beyond that, I'm working on a short radiation series that will look at various ways of detecting radiation and its uses, from the cloud chamber we're going to build today all the way to flowers that change color when irradiated. I want to cover cosmic rays, terrestrial radiation, and do a bunch of experiments with various particle types. All the experiments that I've wanted to try for years, but just never got around to. I'm making a separate video on making each detector so that I don't need to overcrowd the main video so we can just dive into the science. Also, there is a ton of nuclear fear-mongering, not the least of which is the new Chernobyl show. And considering nuclear is essentially the only technology that can actually save humanity from climate change, if I can do my part to show that it's not as scary as it's made out to be, great. Lastly, before we get into it, a quick word about safety. We're dealing with extremely cold temperatures, high voltage, and radioactive material. I don't think I really need to explain that this should be handled with extreme care. Especially the radioactive materials we'll be using should only be handled by professionals, with two exceptions that we'll talk about. Okay, let's jump right in and get building. The core of the machine, as I said, are these Peltier cooling units. Peltiers are neat because as you put power into them, they essentially move heat from one side to the other. So one half gets very hot and the other gets very cold. But they have a pretty firm limit on how much temperature differential they can actually make. So one trick is to stack them to get much colder temperatures. This doesn't make them more efficient or better at cooling lots of stuff at once, but if you need a small area to be really, really cold, they're a great cheap option. The best option is to just get a cascaded Peltier, which is actually just two that are internally stacked, and these are nice because they get very, very cold and you only need to apply a single voltage to them. But I wanted to use what I could quickly get off Amazon so I didn't have to wait for a cascaded one from China. I ended up using a stack of three to get my setup down to temp stably. Two 100 watt and one 60 watt Peltier units. The thing is though, you can't just run them all at the same voltage. As you go higher in the stack, each unit has to pump less and less heat so as to not overwhelm the one it's sitting on. So you run the first one at 12 volts, and then the next two are run at 5 volts. By using the lower wattage unit on the top, you avoid needing a third voltage. Once assembled, the stack quite comfortably gets down to negative 33, which is more than sufficient for this. We also need a place to dump all that heat that the unit produces and moves, so we'll need a massive heatsink and fan. I'm using one we had at the lab, but there's lots of similarly massive units on Amazon for pretty cheap. This also doubles as making the whole machine look awesome, and cool points definitely count, right? To drive everything, I'm using a computer ATX power supply. I chose a 300 watt one that had 3 voltages and could supply large amounts of current to everything as Peltiers hog a ton of power. To get things going, I'm using some silver-based thermal compound between each Peltier layer. Don't be stingy with this stuff. You need a good layer to get full contact between the Peltiers, and the better job you do, the better this will work. Then to lock things in place, I used a little bit of hot glue to seal things in. This is really only there to hold things in place until the whole machine is assembled, as the thermal compound makes the Peltiers pretty slippery and they tend to move around. Now we need a metal plate to cool down, so I picked up this sheet of 2mm copper, and I used a scroll saw to cut a 60mm square piece. You could probably get away with a slightly larger piece if you wanted a bigger active area, but keep in mind that every bit of mass you add is more work for the Peltiers to cool down, and the less likely you'll be to get to the proper temperature. But you can always use more powerful Peltiers if you were so inclined. The plate was given the same thermal compound treatment and then mounted onto the Peltier stack. I did a dry test to make sure that everything gets to temp, and the setup very quickly got down to minus 27. It'll get colder once everything is built, as most of what's keeping this from getting really, really cold is the buildup of ice on the plate, which saps energy out of the system. Unlike water, alcohol doesn't freeze at these temperatures, so once there's a layer on the plate, it'll just get really cold and stay like that. Hence why the complete setup gets 5 or more degrees colder. Once I knew this was working, I could build the rest of the system pretty quickly. I cut out a square of acrylic to be the main platform that our lid will sit on. I also cut out a square of the middle of it to fit the copper plate. I want this to sit flush with the copper so that in a moment when we put a vinyl sticker on it, everything sits flat without weird ledges. I cut 4 acrylic legs to support this platform and then everything was glued into place. While doing this, I also attached a small wire to the copper plate from the underside. Then a black vinyl sticker is applied to cover the whole surface. Not only will this protect the copper, but it also makes the particle tracks far easier to see. A small hole was drilled in the acrylic to allow another wire to be fed through for the upper high voltage lead. Initially, I drilled this pretty close to the edge as I was worried about arcing, but it can be far closer as the high voltage we're using is pretty tame and needs to essentially be touching bare wires to actually arc. I ended up using some acrylic tube to cover this wire, which also made for a convenient place to attach some stainless steel mesh. I got this out of a strainer, but any metal mesh will probably work. To finish off the structure, I added 2 more support columns to help hold up the mesh, and then a second set on top of those. At the top of the pile, I added another piece of mesh, but this is just to support the absorbent pad that gets soaked in alcohol. It's not actually connected to anything. Speaking of which, I just used some black felt as my pad, but literally anything absorbent will work for this. The last thing is my high voltage. My first idea was to use these taser transformers we've used in previous videos, but they have way too much power and arc down through the whole structure and destroy power supplies. Which, in case you can't tell, I learned the hard way. Instead, the ideal power supply actually comes from these bug zapper rackets. They produce a pretty low high voltage, probably no more than a kilovolt or 2, which is more than sufficient and doesn't suffer from the arcing issues. Also, the rackets are a source of mesh, which I realize would have probably been a better option than the strainer, but I didn't think of it at the time, as I initially planned on using the taser thing. The negative is connected to the copper plate, and the positive is connected to the upper grid. Once taken apart, I soldered the button of the high voltage racket so that it's always on, and then attached the remaining leads to the power supply, and then the chamber. The last thing we need is just some lights and a lid. For lights, I'm using an LED strip, and for the lid, I just bought a cheap vase from the dollar store. The LEDs were glued in a ring to the rim of the vase, and we're basically done. All that's left is to pretty things up and tidy up the wiring, which, through the magic of editing, looks like this when it's all done. I ended up adding a bit of mesh on top of my giant fan to prevent fingers getting buzzed, and I also mounted the high voltage supply in its own little box to prevent shocks. I also added a ring of felt to rest the lid on to prevent any air currents making it into the chamber, which would disturb the fog and the effect. But that's it, and we're ready for a test. To prime the system, all we do is pour a bit of 99% isopropanol onto the pad, lower the lid on top, and power it up. It'll take a few minutes to get down to temp, but when it does, the characteristic fog should appear. If you've done everything properly, you'll occasionally see tracks form and then disappear. These are from naturally occurring sources of radiation, like radon or various minerals, and sometimes you get very lucky and catch some cosmic rays coming from space. But to really see this in action, it helps to put something a bit radioactive into the chamber. Let's start with a piece of americium, which I extracted from a smoke detector. For those unaware, smoke detectors use a small piece of radioactive material that constantly spray particles at a detector. If something like smoke enters the device, it stops particles from making it to the detector, which tells the device that there must be smoke and triggers the alarm. Obviously, you shouldn't take smoke detectors apart, and you absolutely shouldn't cut it as much as I have here as you risk damaging the americium and getting radioactive dust on you. But I did this years ago before I knew better. I also have a very sensitive Geiger counter to make sure that I didn't make a terrifying mess. But yeah, don't do this, and if you do, leave the americium in its holder, do not try and extract it like this. Anyway, once it's in the cloud chamber, assuming you've done everything right, you should instantly see a massive flux of thick tracks coming from it. If you see nothing, it's because your high voltage isn't connected properly. Americium is a strong alpha emitter, so almost all of the tracks you're seeing are from alpha particles. They always have this distinct fat trail look. Moving on, here's something which is far safer to handle and I would suggest you use rather than americium. It's a glass marble that has a small amount of uranium oxide mixed into it. This gives the glass this cool green look and also makes it highly fluorescent. You can sort of gauge how much uranium is in here based on the brightness of the glow under UV. The nice part about these is that alpha particles have terrible penetration power, so the glass contains most of them, making this much, much safer to handle. So don't lick it, and personally I'd wear gloves, but a much better choice for a science fair project. Once placed in the chamber, it can take a moment until you start seeing tracks, but pretty soon you'll see a nice, long alpha particle trail come shooting out of it. Also, uranium and its decay chain don't only put out alpha particles, so sometimes you'll see these much finer, wispy, and curly trails. These are beta particles, also known as high-speed electrons. Sometimes they come directly out of the marble, but other times they're there because a gamma ray shot out and dislodged an electron from some air molecule. Unlike alpha and beta particles, gamma rays are just high-energy photons and don't leave the characteristic tracks, and instead are detected as secondary emission of beta particles when they crash into things. In the future, I'll be upgrading the system to include a magnet under the copper plate. This will make the beta particles curl into tight spirals as they respond to the magnetic fields. Next up, a piece of radiation history. One of the many interesting properties of uranium is that its compounds tend to be extremely colorful. Normally they're vibrant green hues, but one of its oxides is vibrant orange. So for years, people used uranium oxide as a glaze for making pottery. In theory, this is actually safe enough to handle, but the issue is that if you chip or break it, the thing spreads radioactive dust everywhere. So we don't do that anymore. But a friend of mine sent me a piece of a plate that was glazed this way. The brand was known as Fiestaware, and they still exist, they just don't use uranium anymore. When I put my piece into the cloud chamber, you can see that once again, copious amounts of alpha particles come flying off of it. Okay, one last example. This one is fun because you can occasionally buy these in stores sometimes. Old-timey gas lanterns aren't actually that bright on their own. The trick is that you have to put this special mesh bag over the flame that is coated in a special oxide. The oxide gets very hot and releases a white light, which makes the lantern much easier to use and far brighter. Thing is, the best oxide for this is thorium dioxide. Thorium is next to uranium and is fairly radioactive itself, so as you'd expect, we get tons of tracks when we put one in a cloud chamber. What's interesting is that while there's still lots of alpha particles, I noticed a lot more beta particles with this. A much safer alternative if you'd like to see tracks from thorium is actually another product you can buy in stores, which is a thorated tungsten rod for TIG welding. For similar reasons, people add thorium to TIG rods as it makes for better welds, but as long as you don't lick it or keep it in your pocket and remember to wash your hands afterwards, they're much safer to handle than these mantles, so make for decent sources for cloud chambers. I just don't have one, otherwise I'd demonstrate it. Another good option is a small tritium vial. These are super safe to handle as long as you don't break them open, and I've ordered a few so that I can use them in future videos. They mostly release low-energy beta particles that look like little puffs around the vial. Cloudy Labs has a great video where they put all sorts of things in cloud chambers, including tritium vials, so I've linked to their video if you'd like to see how this looks. Before we wrap up, another quick note about safety. Obviously, you shouldn't build up a collection of radioactive material like this. I have a suite of various detectors to make sure I haven't contaminated myself and store everything in a metal box. It's not lead-lined yet, and I don't have anything nearly hot enough to really necessitate that, but it really should be. It's been in storage for like 6 or 7 years, so I'm going to try and set a good example and have ordered some lead foil to properly store my collection. And I'll discuss ways to safely store any samples you do have in future videos. If you want to try this, stick to the marbles or tungsten rods unless you're a professional that knows how to handle this stuff and can store it safely. It won't give you cancer just from handling this stuff for a short while, as alpha particles really lack any penetrating power and can't make it past skin, and it's the dose that makes these things dangerous, which in these cases, you'd really have to go out of your way to get a high enough dose to do damage, primarily by eating it. A common X-ray or flying in a plane gives you a higher dose than any of this stuff could over a few minutes of exposure. But if you get any of the dust inside you, that's when it causes real problems, as it can stick around and do damage for ages. So be safe, don't lick uranium, and don't touch the cold bit while the machine is running. But that's basically it. Cloud chambers are amazing little devices that are just mesmerizing to watch even without any radioactive material in them. I honestly almost like them more empty, as it's more exciting when you suddenly see a flash of some particle flying through. And if you watch long enough, you may even catch a cosmic ray, but we'll talk more about those in a later video. Best of all, the whole build can easily be accomplished in an afternoon as long as you've got the right materials. All the materials are either computer parts or from the dollar store, and all I used was a soldering iron and hot glue to put it together. I've put links in the description to some more resources and to the items I used if you'd like to make one yourself. And as I said, this isn't going to be the last time we use this device. I've got 3 or 4 more experiments planned, so be sure to subscribe and ring that bell to see when I post new videos. As always, a big thanks to the many supporters of the channel, both here on YouTube and over on Patreon or Ko-fi. If you'd like to help keep the flow of science videos coming, then consider clicking the links in the description and kicking a buck or two my way. As always, be sure to head over to my other social media pages like Instagram to see these projects long before they end up in videos. That's all for now, and I'll see you next time.